Good morning, one and all. Today's topic is ferrite devices. So in microwave transmission line, so in order to consider different types of waveguide components, we are using the special type of material. It is nothing but a ferrite. All ferrites are non-metallic materials which is having high resistivity, nearly 10 to the power of 14 times greater than metals, and a dielectric coefficient of around 10 to 15 and relative permeability of 1000. So that means it is purely one of the dielectric material having the high characteristics. So basically the ferrites are constructed by the composition of metallic oxide plus ferric oxide. So these are the some of the compositions of ferrites. So zinc ferric oxide, magnesium ferric oxide and manganese ferric oxide. So all these ferrites are having strong magnetic properties. Because of the strong magnetic properties, here it offers two important properties. One is the non-reciprocal property, another one is the Faraday's rotation. Coming to Faraday's rotation in ferrites. When the electromagnetic wave passes through a ferrite, so initially we are considering the ferrite rod of proper length, and here it is placed under DC magnetic field, then linearly polarized wave is propagating through this ferrite material, then it continues to rotate an angle of theta. It is considered to be tilting angle. So this is the initial position of the linearly polarized wave. So after passing through this ferrite material, here it is making an angle in a clockwise direction for angle theta. So here it is the purely non-reciprocal. So that means the direction of the rotation of the linearly polarized wave is independent of the propagation of the wave. So this plane of polarization changes in the same direction, whatever may be direction of the wave propagation, either from forward direction, that is from port 1 to port 2, or in a backward direction, that is port 2 to port 1. Irrespective of the direction of the propagation, so the angle of rotation is same. So it is considered as Faraday's rotation. The three important ferrite devices which we have studied in our syllabus are gyrator, isolator and circulator. So coming to the gyrator. So here it is representing the schematic symbol of the gyrator. It is a simply, it's a two port network of a non-reciprocal device. Here it is having the port 1 and port 2. Here in a forward direction, when the signal is transmitting from port 1 to port 2, here it is offers the 180 degrees phase shift. So similarly, in a backward direction, if the same signal is transmitting from port 2 to port 1, here it is offers the 0 degrees phase shift. It is a simple the operation of the gyrator. So now how can you construct the gyrator and what is the principal operation of the gyrator? So initially this diagram is representing the gyrator structure. So initially we are considering the one rectangular waveguide section with a 90 degrees twister. So here this 90 degrees twister is followed by circular waveguide. So in that circular waveguide section we are placing the ferrite rod of proper length. So based on the rod, ferrite rod dimensions and under magnetic field, permanent DC magnetic field, here this ferrite makes the angle of rotation in a anti-clockwise direction with 90 degrees. So now after that, here it is the circular cross-section is followed by again it's a rectangular transition. So that means for this circular waveguide, see input and we are considering the one rectangular to circular cross-section transition. Similarly at the output end there is a circular to rectangular transition. So for a rectangular waveguide, the dominant mode is TE10. For a circular waveguide, the dominant mode is TE11. So here it is converted. So the dominant mode of the rectangular waveguide TE10 into a dominant mode of the circular waveguide TE11. So now this is a simply the construction. So here we are using the permanent DC magnetic field. Here it is representing the DC magnetic field. So here it is undergo the Faraday's rotation. This ferrite rod must be placed under proper DC magnetic field. So then only because of this composition changes, here it is spin over an angle of theta. So here we are using the twister. So what is the principal operation of the twister? So the twister, here the transition is access a transition from so rectangular to circular along with a phase change of 90 degrees. So in a forward direction from port 1 to port 2, here it is making an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. If the same wave is propagating from port 2 to port 1, it is in a backward direction, then it making an angle of 90 degrees in clockwise direction. So this is the operation of the twister. Here it is representing that in forward direction, that is 1 to 2, 90 degrees rotation in anti-clockwise direction. In a backward direction, that is 2 to 1, 90 degrees rotation in clockwise direction. It is the operation. And here the ferrite rod makes an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction irrespective of the direction of the propagation of the wave, because the ferrites are a non-reciprocal device. Now, so coming to operation. So initially the input signal, that is linearly polarized wave, is propagating through port 1. Now it is entering into this rectangular waveguide. So after that, after passing through this twister, so based on the operation of the twister, it making an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction, because so here the wave is transmitting in a forward direction, so that's why it is making an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. This is the original position. The dotted line is representing the original position of the EM wave which is entering into this twister. After passing through this twister, making an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. After that, this polarized wave is passing through this ferrite rod. According to this Faraday's rotation principle, here it is making an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. So now this is the original position. After passing through this ferrite rod, here it is making an extra 90 degrees. So 90 plus 90, total 180 degrees phase shift. So that 180 degrees rotated wave is propagating through a circular to rectangular transition, and here we are observing the rectangular waveguide of the dominant mode with a 180 degrees phase shift. So finally the output observed at port 2 is same as the input with a phase shift of 180 degrees. Now, so according to gyrator principle, if the power signal is transmitting from port 1 to port 2, offers the 180 degrees. So that condition is satisfied. Now, if the signal is transmitting from port 2 to port 1, what is the operation? Now, so in the second case, so the power is incident at port 2. So here it is against a linearly polarized wave, the electric field arrow mark is representing an upward direction. Now, so after passing through this ferrite rod, irrespective of the direction, here the ferrite makes an angle of 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. So that's why from the initial position, here it is rotated to the 90 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. Now it is passing through a twister. So after passing through this twister, based on the twister operation, in a backward direction making an angle of 90 degrees in clockwise. So that's why again it is coming to a original position. So here it is, now this is the position of the polarized wave. So before entering into this twister, after passing through this twister, it's making an angle of 90 degrees in clockwise direction. So that's why again coming to original position, now the shift is 0 degrees. So if we are observing the signal at port 2 and port 1, both are having the same phase in the second case. So that means in a reverse direction, when the signal is transmitting from port 2 to port 1, here it is offers the 0 degree phase shift. Coming to isolator, the isolator is a two-port unilateral non-reciprocal device. All ferrites are non-reciprocal devices. Here it is isolator is a two-port network. So here it is used to isolate one component from the reflections of the other component in a transmission line. So mainly such type of isolator is used for the matching purposes. So in the first case, if you are observing the diagram, so without isolator, the microwave source is connected to the load. So if the signal is transmitting into this load, if there is any mismatches or impedance mismatches is observed, then some part of the power is reflected back. So as a standing waves. So this standing waves cause instability of the source, or it can also change the frequency. So that's why it is highly undesirable. Now, in order to observe, in order to match the load properly with a microwave source, in order to eliminate the standing waves, so in between microwave source and the load, so we are placing the isolator. So this isolator directs the signal in only one direction, so that is the forward direction. In a backward direction, so if the signal is coming from the load to the microwave signal, so the entire standing waves are absorbed by this isolator. That is the purpose of using this isolator in a transmission line. So now if you are observing this diagram, it's having two ports, port 1, port 2. Here the arrow mark is representing the direction of the propagation. Here the signal is directed in only one direction, that is from port 1 to 2. So no signal is coming from port 2 to port 1. So if you are considering the S matrix is only there is a transmission from 1 to 2. So that means power is incident at port 1, so the output is absorbed at port 2. Then the reflection coefficient is S21. Only the S21 coefficient is exist and remaining all are 0. So here the S11, S22, 0 means these two ports are perfectly matched to the junction. Now here if it is the incident power is equal to reflected power, then the reflection coefficient S21 is considered to be 1. So that's where the S matrix of an isolator is 0, 0, 1, 0. So coming to construction and operation of an isolator. So like as a gyrator, so here we are considering the isolator, but here so at the input transition and output transition, so we are placing the one resistive card. So that resistive card, what is the principle means, it absorbs the parallel components and allows the perpendicular components. So the parallel components which is passing through this resistive cards are absorbed. So that is the properties of the resistive card. And here we are using the at the input end, we are using the 45 degrees twister. So that 45 degrees twister is followed by, so 45 degrees clockwise directed ferrite rod. So the direction of the rotation is purely depends on length of the ferrite rod, dimensions of the ferrite rod and the applied DC magnetic field. So based on these three, by properly selecting here this ferrite rod making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise direction. So after that, again at the output transition, that is a circular to rectangular transition, again we are using the resistive card. So this is the construction of a isolator. Now coming to operation. So mainly we have to know the operation of a resistive card, twister and ferrite rod. The resistive card. The resistive card is the one of the absorbing material. It only absorbs the parallel component and it only allows the perpendicular components with respect to the position of the resistive card. So here is a 45 degrees twister. So it is a reciprocal network. So that means in a forward direction, here it is making an angle of 45 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. In a backward direction, here it is making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise direction, like as a 90 degrees twister. Ferrite rod making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise direction. Now, so according to the operation of a isolator, in a forward direction without any attenuation, it has to pass the signal from port 1 to port 2. So let us verify whether we are getting the same power PI at the output or not. Now, so at the input port, so we are propagating the electromagnetic wave. Here it is representing the linearly polarized wave. So here that wave is initially perpendicular to the plano polarization of the resistive car. So in that perpendicular polarization, so here it is allowed those field lines without any attenuation. So that's why all this linearly polarized wave is passing through this 45 degrees twister. Now, after passing through this 45 degrees twister, here it is making an angle of 45 degrees in anti-clockwise direction. So, this is the original position. Now, it is shifted to 45 degrees in anti-clockwise. After that, passing through a ferrite material in a circular cross-section. So, now the ferrite rod making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise. So, now this is the position which is coming from the twister. So, after passing through this ferrite rod, again it is making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise. Again, it is coming to its original position of 0 degrees. So, after that, again it is a perpendicular to the resistive card. So, that's why it is allowed, and finally we are getting the output same as input without any attenuation. So, the amplitude is same and phase is same. Now coming to second case, if the signal is incident at port 2, this is the input power. So what is the output which is observed at port 1? So again it's a linearly polarized wave which is perpendicular to the resistive current. So that's why without any attenuation it is allowed. Now after passing through this ferrite rod making an angle of 45 degrees in clockwise direction. So it is the original position. This is the angle of rotation 45 degrees. Now, so after passing through this twister, see in a reverse direction, here it is rotating the signal in clockwise direction of 45 degrees. So already here it is making an angle of 45 degrees. One more 45 degrees are done by the twister. So 45 plus 45, total 90 degrees phase shift. Now, so with respect to your resistive card, here it is the parallel component. So all these parallel components are absorbed by the resistive card. So that's why there is no output which is coming from the port 1. So in a forward direction, without any attenuation, the signal is transmitted or directed. In a backward direction, there is no power is coming from this port 1. So this is the operation of an isolator. Coming to circulator. The circulator is a multi-port device which has a property that each terminal is connected to the next clockwise terminal, either clockwise or anti-clockwise terminal. So it is also called as unilateral device. The power flow is only in one direction. So this is the clockwise directed three-port network. So the power is incident at port 1 which is coming from port 3, and no power will be coming from port 2. Similarly, if the power is incident at port 2 in a clockwise direction, the power is coming from port 1 only. No power will be coming from port 3. So similarly, we can construct multi-port devices, either it's a 4-port circulator or 5-port or 6-port or etc. So based on the required operation. But remember that the circulator is a unilateral. The incident power at one port only transmitting through a adjacent port, either in a clockwise or anti-clockwise direction. Here it is providing the directionality as well as unilateral. So here the two important parameters are, one is insertion loss, another one is isolation. So the insertion loss. The insertion loss is representing the by introducing the device or the introducing the network or the port, how much amount of the loss is offered. So the loss always input by output. So that's why here it is representing the 10 log to the base 10 of input incident at port 1 by output coming from port 2. Input by output is representing the insertion loss. Isolation is representing the proper separation. Already here it is told that if the power is incident at port 1, only it is coming from port 3 and no power will be coming from port 2. How much amount of the isolation is provided? So here the 10 log 10 P3 by Pn. So here there is a isolated port, then how much amount is power is coming? So there is amount of isolation. So mainly such type of circulators are used as duplexer in the mixer circuits in a transmitting propagation or etc. circulator operation. Here the circulator is constructed in two ways. So either we are using the ferrite material composition or etc. Otherwise by using the magic tea and the gyrator also we can construct the circulator. So here we are using the two magic tea junctions. So already we know about the magic tea operation. Here it is a four port waveguide junction where all the four ports are perfectly matched to the junction and port opposite ports are said to be isolated because this is the main waveguide and so upward and here it's a linear road E and H ports. The E and H ports and port 1 and 2 of the main waveguide are isolated ports. So such a magic tees are placed in a construction of the circulator along with a gyrator. Then it is simply acts as a 4 port circulator. So for a 4 port circulator, port 1, 2, 3, 4 are representing in a magic tee. So 1, 3 of the second magic tee and 2, 4 representing the first magic tee. So the S matrix of a magic tee is a 3x3 matrix where consisting the 3 port circulator. All the 3 ports are perfectly matched condition, then S11, S22, S33 equals to 0. For a non-reciprocal property, the power is incident at one port, it is only coming from the adjacent port and no power will be coming from port 2. So that means S21 is equals to 0. So with respect to 1, so similarly if the power is incident at port 3, only it is coming from port 2 and no power will be coming from port 1. That means S13 is equals to 0. So similarly if the power is incident at port 2, only it is coming from port 1, no power will be coming from port 3. So that means S32 is equals to 0. So here the combination of S31, S12, S23 is equals to 0 and remainings are exist. So now the 3x3 S matrix of a 3 port circulator becomes 0 0 1 1 0 0 0 1 0. So here the operation of a circulator is purely based on the properties of a magic tee junction. If the power is incident at a port 1, it divides equally in between the adjacent ports and in the both the directions the signal is coming and entering into this second magic tee ports. So with a one is direct wave, another one is a 180 degrees phase shifted wave. So that means an equal amount of the signal with opposite phases are applied, then the sum of the power will be coming from port 2 and difference of the power will be coming from port 4. So that means there is no power will be coming from port 4, only the signal is coming from port 2. So similarly here it is acts as a circulator. Thank you.